actually record. And take it away, Kyle.
All righty. Thank you, Frank. Well, I just want to thank you guys again for inviting me back here. It's going to be a pleasure to teach the class. This is actually one of our most famous classes that we teach. It's called Digital Farming, how to farm your friends and family, and also the farming areas that you're currently farming in. And what we're going to teach you today is how to take your sphere of influence and increase your referral rates using those people that you have worked so hard to get your entire career. So a little bit about the platforms that I'm going to be talking about today. We're going to be talking about email marketing, your website, social media, blogging, search engine optimization, and landing pages, and of course your customer service skills, and how to turn all of those into a 360 degree marketing system to get a close. And the way that we came up with this is that we look at traditional ways of farming and how that people are doing it, and we apply those same ways that they're using and apply those to the digital realm. There's different community pages, like on Facebook, there's pages for each and every community, especially like in Cypress and the Woodlands areas that they're coming up. Wood Forest, I know, is one of them that has their own Facebook business page. These different communities have their own pages, and all the members are on these pages. And that's a really good way to reach out to them and start to feed those leads into your sales funnel. But you can't just reach out to them. You can't just say, hey, I'm a real estate agent, this is what I'm doing. You have to use it in a strategic way, use different manners of marketing, traditional and online, to accomplish your goals. So the first thing that we're going to talk about is build your farm database. The very first thing that you have to have in the digital farming is a database. Now, how many of you guys have a CRM system in place or email marketing system in place? Which one are you using, Robin?
Buffini.
Okay. That's a really good one. Okay, good. So you're already, if you're using Brian Buffini's system, which is a great system, you're already kind of doing a little bit of this digital farming, but this way you can actually attack it on a different level on different communities. So how are some traditional farming, how are you guys currently farming in your areas right now? Are you doing any farming like traditional side? I know you're not, most of yours is referrals. So what about you guys?
We do, in our spirit of influence, we send out a letter with a flyer on different topics once a month. And then we follow that up with a e-flyer
in
the middle of the month.
Okay, so y'all are doing both mail and email marketing. Okay, that's really great. That's actually really, really good. So you're already kind of doing a little bit of what I'm talking about. So now is the time to choose. If you don't have a database or a farming system, then it's time to choose one. What was your name?
Helen.
Okay. I'm Kyle.
Okay.
I think we met before.
Yeah.
Maybe. Yeah, we did.
Uh-huh.
Do you currently have a database that you're using?
Yes.
Which
Buffini,
one?
Buffini.
Oh, you're, so you're using Buffini
yeah.
as well. Okay. So we can already just kind of move past on that. So now you need to create a website that you can easily update. Robin, I know you have one. Are you guys using any of your community pages on your website? Do you have community pages set up on your website yet?
I do have community pages on it. I don't really use them though.
Okay. What we like to teach on the digital farming realm. Say for instance you have a page set up for Wood Forest, and what you would do is you would have a Facebook post about Wood Forest, pump a little bit about $50 to $75 into advertising into this post, and then on that Wood Forest page, have information about Wood Forest, and then have like a place where you can put their name, phone number, and email, like a landing page for that. So whenever you're posting about Wood Forest and you're using those hashtags about Wood Forest on that particular post on social media, on Facebook, Instagram, or wherever else, when they click that link, they're going back to your website that also has the SEO settings. So it'll have, you know, the real estate's name, the agent's name, and then that little pipe separator, and then it'll have Wood Forest right there, and then another keyword maybe, but usually just the real estate agent's name with that a search engine optimization pipe, and then the community name Wood Forest right there. So that, having that set up with using the hashtags on your social media, that is going to be able to direct traffic in itself. Plus you're pumping in about $75 to $50 or $50 to $75 in some advertising on Facebook or wherever, and then directing them to your page. So once they click that link from social media to your website, they can read about Wood Forest, see about what's going on, and then if they see what they like, then they can actually input their name, phone number, and email information in there.
So Kyle, the hashtags, I know they're Twitter. Do they serve any other social media function?
Yes, sir. Pretty much hashtags are on every platform except LinkedIn now. Twitter was the one who originated hashtagging, And now you can use it on Instagram. Facebook just did it probably like a year or two ago. And then I know Pinterest uses them very heavily. And I think pretty much everyone except LinkedIn. LinkedIn, you definitely want to stay away from hashtagging. It's a little bit more of a professional platform.
So, and I may be way beyond the expertise level of these people in the room, but if I do a Facebook post, and say I'm promoting a listing in Wood Forest, and I write my little description, and then at the end of it I put hashtag Wood Forest, how does that help me?
Well, how that's going to help you is, so for if I want to do a search, now let me show you. Let's go to Facebook, I'll show you. At the top of every single Facebook platform, you have the search Facebook thing. So now if I'm a avid social media person and I'm looking for a home in Wood Forest, I'm going to say let's look for hashtag Wood Forest. And now whenever I search for hashtag Wood Forest, it's going to pull up all of the latest, it's not the right one.
It will pull up feeds that have had the hashtag Wood Forest put in them?
Yes, sir.
So we should not only do that, we should do hashtag homes for sale Wood Forest.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
Wood Forest Realty. Yeah, all that kind of stuff.
So it'll pull up all the ones. Actually, this is only pulling up my followers right now. But if I were to put it up on, I might be able to do it on the Safari version of Facebook. But it's going to pull up all the people that have posted that. So whenever, especially on, I'm going to do it on Twitter for sure. Let's do that on Twitter. Be a better example.
Well, I'm not a Twitter user. That's why I was kind of curious if it helps other platforms.
Twitter is really good for driving traffic. And as mentioned in our last class, the digital farming class. Oh, sorry, I didn't repeat that question. I forgot to be doing that. Frank asked, well, how does Twitter affect other platforms in your social media aspect and your website? Well, the reason we use Twitter, in my last class, I mentioned Twitter, that it's the side dish of our social media meal. And then being said that is because you can post as many times as you want on Twitter without turning your audience off. On Facebook, you only want to post 3 to 5 times per week, because if you post a whole bunch of content on Facebook and it's just all strictly your listings and you're just promoting listings and that's all you're doing, you're most likely going to turn your audience off and they're going to be into either unlike your page or just straight ignore your posts and scroll right by them. So what we teach is we teach you to post 3 to 5 times strategically on Facebook, but on Twitter you can actually blow your timeline up as much as you want and use hashtags. And what we teach on Twitter is to use hashtags and then direct every single post with a link to your website. Because with websites and SEO, and the biggest thing that you can have for search engine optimization purposes is links. So a link from your Twitter profile, a link from your Facebook profile, Google regards these as highly valuable links because it's coming from a really highly regarded website such as a social media platform. So now we're going to look for hashtag Wood Forest. So we're going to hit search. And now you're going to be pulling up all of the posts that have that hashtag in Wood Forest. So that's why it's important to use the hashtags on all the platforms, is because if somebody's looking for this information, it's now being brought to you on this. So here's the top tweets, and you can even move over to all tweets. Let's go back, hit the wrong button. So now you can click all tweets up there at the top, and it'll pull up every tweet that has been used. So if I'm avidly searching for something, a house in Wood Forest or things like that, like you said, homes for sale in Wood Forest, that would be a great hashtag. Those are going to be the keywords that are beneficial for that campaign. And like I've discussed with Jess before, some of the things that you really want to do is you want to be hashtagging the same thing that you have keywords for your website. Because if you're not doing this, then you're targeting two different audiences and your marketing is not targeted and it's just kind of out there.
Yeah.
You're just not doing yourself any good. You're kind of just swimming in the water with no direction. So what I like to say is sit down, have your same strategic hashtags that you're going to be using. Make those the same strategic keywords that you're posting on your website or that you're having set up as your metadata and descriptions, metadata, descriptions, and keywords on your website. So if you're going to have a Wood Forest page and you're going to be really farming in Wood Forest, maybe make an extra 2 or 3 pages for Wood Forest and make them all say your name as a real estate agent with that pipeline, Wood Forest. And then have all those pages set up with that same page title. but just have more content, maybe do a YouTube video set up the same way about Wood Forest. YouTube is a really good way. Maybe go create a Pinterest board all about Wood Forest. Use those hashtags and use those same keywords on Pinterest and pin as many photos that you can do on that, so that you're creating a targeted marketing concept. You're not just saying, oh, well, I'm doing Woodlands and over here I'm promoting Wood Forest, because that's two different keywords, two different areas that you're not getting the best results for. So now I'll go back to here. Okay, we're going to talk a little bit about Facebook, the key to your digital farm. We talked a little bit about this statistic last time. Men users, men are 40% more likely to buy or sell a home from a real estate agent they follow on Facebook, and women are 64% more likely. So I know it doesn't add up to 100, but it's not supposed to. It's just 40% more likely than not. Women are 64% more likely than not. So this is really important about how you need to get your sphere of influence onto Facebook. So how do I do this? How do I get my sphere of influence onto Facebook? Well, we talked a little bit about, I know you missed this. What was your name?
Molly.
Molly, hi, I'm Kyle. We were talking a little bit about this earlier. Do you have a CRM system that you main contact with your clients? Everybody else is in here is using Brian Buffini. Is it Top Producer or Peak Producer?
Top Producer.
Top Producer?
Yeah.
Do you have one of those?
No, I don't.
Okay. We talked a little bit about this up here. These are a couple of other ones. MailChimp is actually a CRM system. It's an email marketing system, but it's actually a good way to keep up. It's actually free. If you don't want to come out of pocket, if you're just starting out in real estate or something like that, it's actually really free and highly user-friendly as well.
Which one, I'm sorry?
MailChimp. It's free.
As a CRM?
Yes, as a beginner CRM. It's what we call it, because I've done CRM solutions for beginner agents, professional, and then full teams. If you're having a full team, MailChimp is not for you. But if you're just starting out, you're actually able, MailChimp is now giving you a way to keep track of your clients. It's actually almost a fully integrated CRM. It's not advanced, but it's very easy to use. It's easy to input all your emails information. Now they give you places to put phone numbers. You can even start to add their social medias now.
What's your favorite advanced CRM?
I actually like, I'm a big fan of Marcia Soderbergh. It's called Contactually. Hers is really good. I love it. I like the way it's integrated. I haven't really got to get my hands into it, but from what I'm looking at it, it's actually really cool. And I've actually got into, there's a new one coming out in Remax. One of my other clients, she's a Remax agent in Cyprus.
Yes.
She got the opportunity to get her hands on the new Remax CRM system that's coming out like in January.
The Homes.com system?
Homes.com. And that is cool. Okay. You're going to be able to put all of your social media on there. You'll actually be able to take people from Facebook and put them on there. So you can go to your CRM system. They have their picture there because they're on your Facebook. So I played with that a little bit, and I like it a lot. So that's probably my new favorite one, actually, especially because you guys are Remax here already. So I would definitely suggest the Homes.com system as well. Okay, so back to forming our Facebook. How to get everybody on your Facebook. What I want to talk about real quick before I hit on some of the bullet points. One of the biggest things is having your CRM system in place. So if you have that CRM system, you're sending out your emails. What you need to do in your email signature is have your Facebook business page URL there. So have facebook.com/ your name, and or a lot of people have like their name and area. So it's just kind of however you want to do it. So make sure that your Facebook page is actually being promoted on every single email you're sending out. I mean, you're already emailing everybody all the time. You're sending emails 24/7. You know, you're in bed about to go to sleep about to send emails. So why not let everybody know, hey, this is my Facebook business page. This is what I'm doing. So we've already created a professional business page. Now it's time to add all of your friends, family, and associates. How many of you have your sphere of influence already onto your Facebook page? Robin, what about you? Got them on there? Okay, good. Now, there's a certain way to talk about your professional page on your personal page that you need to do. You can't promote real estate on your personal page, but you can promote your business page on your personal page. I know you're going to say, I see a lot of people do it. You are going to see a lot of people do it, but that's also taking the risk and the chance of getting your Facebook page suspended, or in some cases you won't even be able to maintain a business page at all. So what you can do is called checking into your business page, and I went over this in the social media meal. Do you all remember how to do that? Remember how to check into your business pages? Yeah, okay, we'll go over that again. Let's go back here.
I'm going to have you come back for that class so I can record it.
It's a good class. It's one, another one of our famous ones. Okay, so let's go to post.
So, Kyle, if we have a business page post, is it a problem if we share that to our personal page?
No, it's not.
Ah.
That is perfect. You can do that.
Okay.
You can do that. But here's a way to post about your business page here. So say you're meeting with the escrow officer and you're trying to get everything lined up. So what you would do is meeting with escrow. And you throw a hashtag in there. Say we are still trying to farm wood forest. And see, you can hashtag the name of the title company of whoever you're meeting with. And if that person that you're meeting with has a personal page and they want to be known, you can click that little tag button right there, a little image of a person, and you can tag that person on there. But what we're going to do is we're going to check into our business page. So I'm here. I'm meeting with my escrow officer today. I've done my hashtag. I've tagged my good friend that is helping me out. And now I'm going to click that little button. Did y'all see which one it was?
Yeah.
No.
It's that little teardrop appearing one right there. And what that's going to do is going to pull up the place that you are at or that you're near already, because Facebook is kind of like a stalker. It knows where you're at all times. But you don't have to do that. What you can do is search for your business page. And I found ours, so I'm going to click on that, and now I'm checked in. So it's going to say, it's automatically going to pull up, who are you with? So now, wherever my post is going to say, at there. So if I'm a real estate agent, well, I'll show you how it looks like. We'll just do it for one of the agents. Let's do it for Marsha's. So now I'm actually checked into Marsha's Facebook business page. So it's a way, pretend I'm Marsha. So now I'm meeting with the escrow, I've done my hashtags, I've hashtagged the title company that I'm with, and now I'm actually tagging my business page. And what this is doing, this is consistently reminding your peers, your people that are on your personal page, hey, man, they work in real estate. They might have forgot that you're an agent, but what you're doing is creating top of mind all the time. That's what you really want to do with Facebook, is create top of mind and always grow your sphere of influence outwards. Just grow with as many people as possible. So without saying, hey, I'm a real estate agent, come talk to me today, you're actually telling the people that are interested in real estate without really telling them. If you're saying, hey, I'm busy at work, I work hard for my clients. Or you could even throw that in the post. Meeting with the escrow officer today for one of my clients. I consistently work hard to make sure they're getting the best deal or something like that. So, again, and that reminds people. So maybe they're looking for a home. Again, they forgot that you were an agent, or maybe they just haven't talked to you in a long time. They're an old high school friend that maybe just added you on Facebook a couple weeks ago. You just went to your 10, 15, 20-year reunion, whatever. They added you. You didn't get a chance to talk about business that much, but now that they've added you and they see you posting about it, oh, man, I actually wanted to talk to them about a home. I'm actually trying to sell my home now. So that's what we're going to try to do with our personal page, is create top of mind without having to actually blow up your Facebook, blow it up with meaningless posts about listings and things like that. What you really want to do is make people know that you're a hard worker, that you're a community activist, that you know what's going on in the community. So if like you're going to an event I know in Cypress they have this thing called the Zombie Stomp. It's like a big thing for Cypress Creek Lakes. That would be a good thing to post about. If they have different Halloween events going on in Wood Forest, Spring, Woodlands around the area, go to those events, post pictures, hashtag it, tag your business page into those posts. And that's going to, when people start seeing that you're active in the community and that you're a hardworking real estate agent, that's when you'll start to see a little bit more referrals come from social media as well. So now, Now that you've gotten your friends and family and your associates, you're reminding them on your personal page. Now it's time to take the people from your personal page and put them onto your business page. And there's a way to do that, and it's called inviting them. And we went a little bit over this last time. Do y'all remember how to invite people to your page? All right, let's go back and just do that. So now, let's discard that post. So now let's just go to this page. So now there is an option. I might have to go through Safari to do it. There used to be a way where we talked about it last time. Okay, here we go. On this one, it's showing up. So now, right underneath your business page where you have all of your information and your profile picture, it's going to say how many likes you have, promote your page, and then invite friends to like this page. So it's going to be your personal friends. You click on that, and then all of your friends lists are going to pop up. They should. Okay, so here are all of my friends. So now I can actually invite every single one of these people to like my page. But you don't want to invite all of them at one time. I went over this in the last class. If you invite 200 or 300 people at a time, Facebook can kind of consider that spam is only going to let you do about 20% of those. Ooh. So they won't even see your invite. So what you want to do is do 5 to 10 per hour. Let it chill, relax for a second, come back in another hour or two later, do it that way. Or maybe just do 10 a day. In case because you're probably going to be doing other things within an hour. So just do about 5 to 10 a day. 10 would be a safe number. It's okay. And after that, you just kind of want to leave everything alone and just, you don't want to blow up the
So will it tell you if they have already liked your page?
Yes, it will. It'll say already liked or already invited. And then probably like every 30 to 60 days, it'll refresh.
You will get notification who liked your page.
Yeah. Yeah, but I wasn't here for that class, and I invited all of them at one time.
Yeah.
And so it sounds like I need to redo.
Yep, definitely, because only 20% of the people probably saw it.
Okay, and so when you invite them to like it, then anything you post on that is going to show up on their page, right? Just because they like it?
Yes, when they like, that's how people follow your page, is they like your page, and then so all of your posts will now show up on their news feed.
Gotcha.
If they're logged in at that time. And kind of what we went over last time, how to make sure your post is staying on top of the timeline, is to get likes, shares, and comments. And do y'all remember what was the heaviest weight? Which one of those three had the heaviest weight?
Comments.
No. Shares. Shares have the heaviest weight. So if you share, if somebody shares your post, then it's going to, it's going to pop up not only in their timeline, but all of their friends' timelines. So that's really good. So commenting is the second highest one. That means people are engaging into your post, and it's just the Facebook algorithm how it works. So if somebody comments on that page now, it's become that much more powerful. Now it's going to also show up on other people's timelines, just not as highly ranked. And then last and definitely not least is likes, because if you get a post that has like 300 likes, that's 300 likes is more powerful than one share. You know what I mean? So it's like, one like is definitely not equal to one share, but a whole bunch of likes is equal to about one share. So whenever you're doing that, remember, try to keep that on top of your timelines at all times. So now, okay, say I've invited people and they're still not really responding to my invite. They're just not there. Message all of your contacts 5 to 10 at a time. Ooh, where we go? Message all of your contacts 5 to 10 at a time and ask them to follow your page. Compose a message that is friendly and inviting, then just replace the name at the top of the message. So you can just, if you have Bob, Susie, John, and Will, just replace that name. Bob, hey, I want you to take a look at my Facebook business page. I'm posting a lot of useful information on there you could actually use, da 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 da. Boom, and just take, copy, paste, go to the next person, replace Will with Bob. Boom, paste, go to the next one. And then just keep going down that list until you kind of messaged everybody too. So not only are you inviting everybody, you've also sent them a personal message. And they see their name on it. And maybe if you know that person had a kid lately, or if that person is going on vacation or anything that you see that they're doing on the Facebook business page, maybe throw that in there so it makes it even more personal so that they don't think that they're talking to you just like you're sending out some kind of mass message. And that's what you're going to see the best results to come to as well. Use your Facebook to promote your testimonials and encourage all of your friends and family to engage with you on your posts. Your immediate support system can share your page and all of your information to their network of friends. Some people say, I don't know, well, I have a lot of friends and they have kids. What's the point of having my kids on there or their kids on there? I don't really kind of want that. I actually had one of the people that I consult with, they had a kid that followed them on their Twitter page. And it was a high school kid, maybe like a freshman or maybe junior high, something like that. And they were following them on, it was one of her mom's friends, and she was a real estate agent. And she posted something about the high school, and he retweeted it. And his teacher happened to be following him on Twitter as well, and was happening to look for a home at that time. Well, then he's like, oh, well, I seen you tweeted about that, and she's a real estate agent, and she's really good. He's like, yeah, that's really cool. So high schools are really highly engaging on Twitter. It's another thing to digitally farm. So if you're going to target the high schools in the area, if you're targeting the Woodlands, follow the Woodlands on Twitter, retweet the Woodlands on Twitter, all the different high schools that they have, engage with them, reply to their tweets, things like that. That's also a good way to get really good exposure. High schools are highly, highly active on Twitter. And they also have Facebook business pages as well. Or not business, they have Facebook pages, but they're, I guess, technically it is a business page. But they do have Facebook pages as well that you can follow and like. But the where I've seen the most traffic and results come from Facebook, I mean from high schools and schools, the junior highs and things like that, is on Twitter. Even elementary schools have Twitters, and that's another, again, you're not going after the kids, you're going after the teachers, the principals, the admins, and the secretaries. So that's something to really good to think about. Reach out to extended family, target all extended family, young or old, and I already talked about why we want to target the young ones.
You need a refill?
Oh, no, I'm good. And that should last me another 30 minutes.
Hey, since we did that, can I move you just a few inches?
Yes, sir, for sure.
There you go.
All right. Okay, farming your Facebook for referrals. Once you have your Facebook online and working, start using it to gather email addresses for all of your email marketing campaigns. You can garner all of your contacts from Facebook and enter them into your database or CRM and ask them to share your information with people they know. The most results that we get from digital farming is through email marketing, through getting your sphere of influence on that, because that is the most highly shareable information that you can give. Of course, people, it's really easy for them to hit that share button on Facebook. It's really easy, but it's just as easy and even more personal to hit that forward button on that email. So what we're trying to create is, again, that 360-degree system. Facebook, they can hit share. Emails, they can hit forward. Twitter, they can hit retweet. You're just giving them your sphere of influence, more opportunities to share your information. So taking them from Facebook and then putting them on your email marketing is making them active on another platform for you. Because why? I mean, you don't have to have a huge marketing system if you just have your sphere of influence doing work for you at all times. You should be able to get a very good good leads. And a lot of you are using the Brian Buffini system, so you know that this can work. So talk to your friends, family, and past clients about sharing your information with people in their network. This keeps you on their top. This keeps you on their mind and ready to give you a referral. Instant access to information increases the speeds and number of referrals. So I've been talking about different things. Does anybody know, I talked about this in the last class, what is the hottest lead possible? Do y'all remember?
I'd like to see this house.
What is the hottest, even hotter than that?
Oh, referral.
Yeah. The hottest lead possible is a referral, and that's what we're trying to create through this system. We're trying to get a referral. We're trying to get somebody that knows you that is looking for real estate. Especially this summer, there was probably somebody in your sphere of influence was looking for a house. Definitely. I mean, just the way that the real estate market was going. And so that's what we're trying to create, is somebody out there is looking for a home that's in your sphere of influence. Where are they looking for it? And you're giving them access to to forward that email, hit that share button on Facebook, or hit that retweet button on Twitter, et cetera, et cetera. So now, publicly thank all of your new likes and comments and mentions. Use your business page to promote other local restaurants. Talk to them individually and ask about posting about their restaurant or business. Then ask them about getting a house. So a really good thing about doing this is, say if there's a local garage shop or a local restaurant and you're kind of cool with the owner, what we have seen some really good results from is posting that business page. Remember how I showed you how to check in? You can do that from your business page and check into another business page. So you could go to a restaurant, you could go to, like I said, a garage shop is a good one, a lot of traffic through there. Especially a lot of the, like the high-end ones, like to have all those Ferraris and stuff like that outside, that'd be a good one to target. What you want to do is you tag that business page inside of your post. It's the same way that I showed you earlier. And what that does is cross-promotion. And you're promoting somebody's other business on your business. And you're like, well, why should I promote somebody else's business on my business page? That doesn't make sense for me. But what you're doing is that post is now going to show up on their timeline, and all the people who like their page are going to see it. So now you're exposing your business page to all of their friends and family and people that follow their business as well. So cross-promotion is a big thing to do on digital farming. So now we've got the high schools in the area where we're on their business pages, and now we're targeting the local restaurants and the car shops and the tire shops and the pet stores and whatever else could be. So say you're going to the local local sushi shop. You're going in there. It'd be a good idea to check in from your business page and check in from your business page, not your personal page. Check in from your business page to their business page. Promote their page. Hey, this is great sushi. Throw a photo on there. Remember the four or five things from each post from the last class? You need to have a photo, tag, hashtag, and link. So, that being said, make sure that you're taking a photo for your post. It's going to look a lot better.
And then when you post on your business page, it shows up on your personal page, right?
No, it will not. Which you can now share that post on from your personal page.
Gotcha.
So if you're on your personal page, go to your business page and hit that share
and
button.
Share. Okay, that's right. Okay.
And it's gonna help that post out as well. So that'd be a good idea to do. So
quick question.
Yes, ma'am.
Not to interrupt you. For the link, do you suggest putting, because if you put a link, it automatically picks it up and you can go ahead and delete it. Do you suggest to leave the link in there rather than like people clicking on the picture?
It kind of depends. If I would leave it in there, just that would just be my thing that I would do. But if it's like on Twitter and you need to get rid of some characters, I would knock it out.
Right.
Because a lot of things, like if you're posting through Hootsuite or you're posting through a third party software, and I think homes.com is actually, their platform is actually going to let you post from that as well. I'm still kind of tinkering with it. We're still figuring it out. But what you want to do is make sure that those characters are going to be able to fit inside of Twitter, Google+, Instagram, Twitter. But I think Twitter, I just heard recently that they're getting rid of their 140 character limit. So,
I read that too.
So that's pretty much going to be null and void anyway. So, so that being said, would I leave the link on there? I would leave it on there.
Okay.
But that's just me. If they're going to click the picture and go to it anyway, what's the point? Does it matter? Maybe. I don't know.
Okay.
Well, what I would do is actually, I would test and measure. I would do about 3 to 5 posts with a link and do 3 to 5 posts without a link, then log into my Facebook Insights and see which post performed better and how many people actually clicked the link and went to it. Therefore, because some people's audience may be different. Like Robin's audience may like to see the link there and click it, whereas yours might just want to click directly on the picture and go there. You don't know. The only way to do it is to test, analyze, and measure, and then see what's performing the best. Okay, but this is highly important. I'm going to mention this again, and publicly thank all new likes and mentions. So if there's a comment, somebody just commented on my post. It's for an open. Say if I just paid a whole lot of money, like $75 for this this advertising post for my open house. I'm trying to promote it. And what happens on these posts is that other people tag friends and family that they want to see. I can show you from one this weekend that I did from one of my other clients. Don't judge me. It's a Better Homes and Gardens one. But it's just a good example.
We do business with them too, by the way.
Well, I was at a one class in Remix, and they were like, you should never mention that you do business with a Better Homes at Remax place. I was like, well, sorry.
It's a cooperative industry, yeah. So no reason to be scared.
But yeah, we're not scared of them.
Okay, so here is the post that we did for her open house. And we posted it with photos and threw some hashtags in there. And this is what happened. Other people started commenting, tagging their friends and family. So like Benny obviously thought that Claudia was interested in a house like this. Ruben for Denise, same thing. So what I did, remember I said publicly like and thank? I went and I liked all of these people that did it. So they commented on my post. I went and I liked every single one. This guy actually commented and said, very nice. So I commented back, said, thanks TJ and Jay. I wasn't able to actually tag them in this post. For some reason, Facebook was acting up. But on this one, I was actually able to tag her name. See, I was a little bit bold right there. So if somebody comments on your post, you can actually say thanks. You tag them on it and then leave them a message. So that's probably one of the biggest things, because she's not only going to get a notification, she's going to get two notifications for this. She's going to get the notification that Debbie actually commented on the same post that she commented on, and then she's going to get another notification saying that Debbie tags you in the comment. So she's going to see you twice. And then, she said, okay, you know, talk to him. So everybody that posted on this post, I liked. And again, it's people that are tagging other people on there. So that's really good. So that's another good way to say, hey, thanks for, you know, exposing me, or thanks for, you know, tagging your friend on this post. But that's really, really important to do, because if somebody's taking the time to tag other person or to compliment your home that you're selling or that you're listing, it's very important to thank them and make them feel appreciated. Farming your LinkedIn network. So now, does anybody have any questions about Facebook before we move on? Any other questions? Okay. How to use LinkedIn. Now, LinkedIn, before we talked a little bit about it in the last class, it's a lot more professional than Facebook. You need to kind of have your why already in mind of what you're going to be doing. If you're going to be increasing exposure for listings, or if you're going to be trying to go after buyers, go after sellers, or if you're going more B2B, you're trying to go after other real estate agents, try to get more buyers, you need to have this in mind already. You don't want to go in, again, you don't want to have a non-targeted campaign where you're just posting stuff out there. You need to have a why. So you're going to use your LinkedIn network to add people into your digital farming database. How am I going to do that? If you have a LinkedIn profile and they have and you made a connection with them, their name, their phone number, and their email is actually listed on their profile. So do y'all remember if we talked about last time how to farm business on LinkedIn business pages a little bit? Okay, we only have 20 minutes, but I would show you. But if you have questions about after the class, I'll be glad to show you kind of how to do this. And what you do is you can go to, what's a local business here? That's pretty close by, besides Exxon.
Harry's.
Okay.
Perry's
Steakhouse. Okay. So, all right, we're going to go to Perry's Steakhouse. We're going to go to their LinkedIn business page. And they may or may not have one. But if they do have one, what they're going to do, all of their employees will now be listed on their profile. And you can actually see their name, their phone numbers, and information. So you can now farm these people from LinkedIn and put them into your database. And a good thing about that is that you know where they work. You have maybe have met them a time or two if they were your waiter, your hostess. So that is a really good tool to kind of think about. I don't know of any off the top of my head, but as you drive around, as you do business with people in the area, think about going to those LinkedIn business pages and looking for those profiles, and looking at who works where and being able to add their information to your database and increasing your sphere of influence in the farming areas. So if you're wherever you're looking to farm, wherever you're looking to try to get listings at, that's where you want to target the same area. So you don't want to target the Woodlands High School if you're going to be going after the restaurants in Spring. You know what I mean? If you're going after the Woodlands High School, you need to go after those the Woodlands Elementaries, the Woodlands Junior Highs. You need to go after the restaurants that are around the Woodlands High School and things like that. Make your targeting a zone target as much as you can. Because like I said, you don't want your efforts to be going nowhere. So at least that's what I teach. Other people are like, oh, well, I'd like to dominate everything and just take over. What I like to do is I like to take over a small area first, make sure that all my keywords, hashtags, and things are set up for a small area, and then be able to move on to bigger things. Because if you try to just take over Houston as a whole, it's going to take a very long time or a lot of money in advertising. And what I teach is a slow, more detailed, linear method than more, say, for instance, if you're doing dynamic, you're going to Houston, you're going to Woodlands, Conroe, your efforts aren't going to be as centered as targeted. And I find that more results for especially individual real estate agents come from a strategic zone targeted marketing campaign. So that being said, you can search for specific companies and places directly on LinkedIn in your target area. It makes it easy to target your specific area to farm. And now you can even start groups. You can start a group on LinkedIn and talk about discussions and things like that. It's actually a really good way to get leads and to talk to other people. It's a little bit hard to get started, but if you get other people involved in it, then it becomes very easy because everybody else is doing the work for you. You can actually monitor the group and say, for instance, if another real estate agent wants to get in on it, you can click deny and they can't get in your own group. So you can, it's highly manageable. A little bit more technical. Actually, LinkedIn is probably the most technical social media platform there is. But it's, again, you can manage it to the T. And if you're gonna, just as a general idea on LinkedIn, it's just to be about postings and things like that. You don't wanna post like the happy-go-lucky posts that you would probably do on Instagram and Facebook with emojis and stuff. Stay away from emojis on LinkedIn. Stay away from hashtags on LinkedIn, because if you hashtag on LinkedIn, you're going to look not smart. You're going to, because they're not utilized on LinkedIn, so people are going to be like, idiot, why do they use a hashtag on LinkedIn? So don't do that. You probably, if you're going to be doing some farming on LinkedIn, you might want to do like community events or like business reviews, maybe things like that. So stuff that could really engage people in it. Again, like if you go and eat a good steak at Perry's, like a nice review of the steak would be good. You know, tag their business page in the post. You could, if there's a small, I know there's like Anadarko is here too in Woodlands, or maybe even smaller oil and gas company that you could know somebody that's working for. You can actually go recommend them on LinkedIn, all the employees there. That'd be a really good tool. So if I'm working for this company, we can probably go to their Anadarko's LinkedIn business page, see all their employees that are working there. Then you can actually go on there, see if you have any mutual connections, and then just recommend all of their, if they say like they're a drilling specialist or something like that, go and recommend them for those skills. And they'll get a notification not only on LinkedIn, but in their email, like, oh, this person has recommended you, this person has recommended you. And they'll be like, oh, well, what do they recommend? Oh, she's a real estate agent. Oh, that's cool. So it's just kind of, again, just creating top of mind of advertising. And these are all free ways of doing it. And LinkedIn has a few paid ways of doing some things like this. And they actually do it for you instead of you actually going and manually farming your leads for you. LinkedIn has a paid advertising way and also a paid platform that they give you. I did the 30-day trial, so I didn't get to really dive into it too much. But the experience that I did get with it was phenomenal. I got really good results from it. I got a lot of really good leads from it. And I think that it could really work for real estate if you had a really good campaign to start out with. I wouldn't just go spend money on it, again, not knowing why or knowing what I was going to do. But it's something to look into if you're looking for a new way to get leads. Okay. Again, we talked about recommending others. We talked about solving problems on the group discussions. Again, this is another messaging. Same thing we did on Facebook. Personally send them a message 5 to 10 people at a time. Hey, I'm on LinkedIn. Check out my business page. Check me out here. If you want to get more information on the emails, shoot me your email address. And again, respond to everyone who communicates with you and be timely in your responses as well. And then farming your Twittersphere. So we only got about 10 more minutes. We've talked a lot about Twitter. Establish yourself as a knowledgeable source of information. Again, Twitter is really good for community tweets. A lot of restaurants are highly active on Twitter. Follow all industry-related accounts. It's really commonplace to find other real estate agents and people on Twitter, and it's okay. Maybe you want to stay away from that on Facebook, because Twitter is more of a branding / search engine optimization platform more than is lead gen. So like on your lead generation platforms, which are going to be Facebook and LinkedIn, and Instagram is a little bit of like a call to hybrid, it's a little bit of both. You kind of want to stay away from following other real estate agents and engaging with them, like on Facebook and LinkedIn, whereas things like Twitter, it's perfectly fine. You can just follow all the real estate agents. It actually helps grow your presence online, so I would actually recommend it. On LinkedIn, I would recommend connecting with them, but just not engaging with other real estate agents, because then it's just going to show up on your post. But as long as you connect with them, you should be fine. See, create a strategy that includes relevant and newsworthy content along with inspirational and motivational tweets that inspire your followers to get engaged in the conversation. Hashtag Motivational Monday is a really popular thing on Twitter. Throwback Thursday, TBT, is a really popular one. Those are actually really highly engaging, highly retweetable things that people expose you to. So, like the other day, one of the interesting tweets that one of my clients did, they had a picture of Houston in like 1903 or 1933 or some crazy. And it showed like Main Street and where the medical center is now. And they used the Throwback Thursday. They got like 60 or 70 retweets, and they only have like 300 followers. So that's actually a really good tweet that they did. People saw the picture, they really liked it. So things like that is really cool. If you can go in and find old pictures of the Woodlands, hashtag and Throwback Thursday, hashtag in the Woodlands, that would be a good idea. The things that started out, like, you know, when it first was established or something like that. And then if you get even a little bit more advanced, if it's a color photo, you can even throw a black and white filter on it and make it look even older. Things like that, just use creative things like that. Twitter, again, you can, Twitter, you don't have to worry about posting too many times on. People actually like to see you post a lot on Twitter. Does anybody have any questions about LinkedIn or Twitter? I know I went through it rather fast. I'm trying to get you off.
So don't feel the pressure to rush. You don't have to cut off right at 11. So don't.
Okay.
Just don't feel that pressure.
Okay, cool. Well, that's fine. That lets me go a little bit slower. All right. Get your younger generation involved. Again, family, friends, kids, all of them. Talk to them about sharing your information. Like I said, don't be afraid to get high school kids and junior high kids onto your Twitter. It's really good for referring people into their sphere of influence as well. Tweepy is actually a really great app to manage your followers and increase them at a steady pace, and that's spelled T-W-E-E-P-I. And what that does, say for instance, if I wanted to go and follow somebody on, or if I wanted to follow all the people that are following, you know, the Woodlands, the Woodlands probably has this on Twitter. So say for instance, I want to go and follow all of the people on there. This app will actually allow you to do that. And what you don't want to do is you don't want to go and just follow everybody. Tweepy will give you where they're from, when the last time that they tweeted, and if they're active on Twitter. So if you go, it'll have their profile picture. If their profile picture is an egg on Twitter, you don't want to follow them if they don't have a profile picture. Even if they are active, and it says active 19 minutes ago, and they have an egg picture, don't do it. It's most likely a fake profile. So you don't want to engage with those profiles at all. It kind of makes your profile not look as good either. So don't do that. But if you have that, if you're using the Tweepy app and you see somebody that says they are from the Woodlands, they were active 2 or 3 days ago, and their last tweet was no less than a week ago, then that's going to be somebody you'd like to follow. And what you do is you go, the Woodlands probably has thousands of followers. So you're going to go in there and you're going to follow all of these people. All of them at a time. And then you can go to the Woodlands High School, follow all of them people. Woodlands Junior High, follow all those people. Perry Steakhouse, go follow all of those people. What you're going to do is, again, not all of them, but the ones that are going to be valuable to you. And what you're going to do with that is start posting relevant information for that area so people can start to look at you as a community expert. And what that does is, say, whenever you follow them, they're going to get that notification hey, Robin is now following you. Robin is now following you. And then what I get, what I see is about a 50% response rate. 50% of the people are going to follow you back, and 50% are just not going to. So, but sometimes I've seen it go up to 75 to 80% for where people follow you back. If, say, for instance, if I go to the Woodlands High School and I'm following all the people that I see valuable, and I'm seeing like 3 out of those 4 people that I follow are following me back, I want to just keep going on that one. But if I go and I follow, say, Perry Steakhouse, and I only get 1 out of 10 people following me back, I may not spend my time farming that particular profile. Okay, so we talked about that. It's really good at Tweepy. It's TWEEPI.com. Okay, here we go. Farming for referrals on Twitter. Follow accounts that are related to the real estate field. And we talked about this a little bit. Title agents, title companies, brokers, construction companies, and home builders, just to name a few. What this does is establishes credibility. So say, for instance, you're doing your active duty on Twitter. You're tweeting. You're doing your everything that you should be doing. And you get somebody that's on Twitter and they're interested. Oh, wow, I'm actually interested in what Robin has going on. I'm going to click on Robin's profile. I'm going to go to her profile. I'm going to see who she's following. So it says that she's following Darling Homes, Perry Homes, Jaeger Homes, all these different nice home builders. Wow, that's really cool. She's also engaging with all these different title companies and home inspectors. So obviously, Robin has a really safe network of people that makes me feel better about choosing to sell or buy my home with Robin. So that's why you want to have industry-related people, because once you get the hook, now it's time to reel them in. And having those profiles set there, this is going to help you reel them in even more, make it a little bit easier anyways. Retweet the accounts that you are following and who post industry-related content. So once you're following these people, the title companies, the different companies like that, you want to click that retweet button every time they do something that pertains to your area or that is into your industry, something like that, or in that really industry, I guess, in your area. So if they're tweeting about something that interests you, or maybe the title company just retweeted something about, they sent out a notification about a brand new like a home builder assistance program or something that nobody else needs has posted about yet, that would be a good retweet for your page. Hit that retweet button, engage with them, comment on it, and when you comment, you can actually hit that at button and tag them, and I'll show you. No, let's do that. Okay, so say for instance, I just did my hashtag Woodforest and the nursing job in Houston, looking for a DeVito Woodforest dialysis. Let's not do that one. Let's do, okay, so this is a good one. Connoisseurs for Charity, Woodforest. So if I would get, what I want to do here is I'm going to go here, and this is the retweet button. So I'm going to click that retweet button.
Where is it?
Right there.
Oh, okay.
So now I can now hit retweet. And now I'm going to hit this reply button right here. And now what I'm going to do is it already does it for you. When you hit reply, it tags everybody in that post. So it's going to tag this guy, Scott, and it's going to tag everybody else that he tagged into it or that has replied to it. So now you're getting exposure to every single person that did that post. So now you've got the restaurant, you got the Reef, which is another restaurant, Amerigo's Grill, which is another restaurant, and Ibiza, I don't know if that's a restaurant or not. But those are all places that you are now going to be exposed to your reply. So now you're going to say, awesome event, had a great time, and then throw your hashtag in there, and then you're done, and you can click tweet at the bottom. So that's actually something that is really useful tool to use, like use for the hashtag search or something like that. But engaging is one of the biggest things that you want to be able to do on Twitter.
A very practical question, because I just did my first ever hashtag.
Yay!
I'm trying to put it into practice. And I did two. Are you supposed to put a comma after the first hashtag if you're doing two?
No.
So just a space?
Just a space,
Excuse me. All right, thank you.
You're very welcome, yes, sir.
Those are the questions that come up when you take action.
Okay, and then we did that. So I always, one of the biggest things I call is RTRP, And that applies for Twitter is retweet, repeat, repost. So just remember that RTRP is it can mean retweet, repost, reply, whatever you kind of wanted to say. I just named it RTRP. Just remember that retweet, repost, reply is something that you need to be able to do. If you're doing all this hard work on Twitter, you're following all these people, you're doing all this, you need to take the time to, again, like on Facebook, we talked about commenting and liking and thanking these people. You need to do the same thing that you're doing on Twitter. Retweet, reply. It's a really good tool to keep engaging with them. Come up with a referral plan for Twitter. Ask for followers to share information with their peers. And not just for Twitter, what I would do is I would come up with a referral plan to use on all of my platforms. I would use it for email marketing, and I would use that same campaign and put it on my Facebook, my Twitter, Instagram, all these platforms. And what I would do is you have a listing and you want to create a referral program for, let's say, a private showing. So you could do tag somebody in this post, have them do a private showing, and whoever does that tag, I'll give them a $25 gift card to Perry's or something like that, or to, you know, Red Lobster, some crazy restaurant or something, or to a local boutique or something, you know, whatever you, if you have more females in your sphere of influence than a boutique, you're going to get a lot of people that want to do that, because girls, they like Pinterest, they like Twitter, they like all these different things. Having like a boutique gift card or like one of these nice like indoor, talk to maybe if you have a good relationship with an interior decorator that has maybe an open shop, that'd be a good idea to get people involved. Hey, just do a cross promotion program where I involve your interior decorating company, like a $100 gift card, and I'm going to use that to help get exposure for this listing, or something like maybe $150 off home staging or something different like that. Cross promotion, again, is one of the biggest tools that you can use in social media. But that would be a good referral plan. So you can not just a referral plan, but you can, like I said, cross promotion referral programs. You can get really creative with it. And it just kind of depends on, again, who you're targeting and where you're targeting them at, to where you would come up with a different campaign. Again, this applies to all the platforms. Message your people 5 to 10 at a time to build your farm. Our ultimate goal is to take everybody from social media and putting them on our email marketing platform. That's what our goal is, so that we can get them into our CRM database, so that we can engage with them. And then whenever, if you guys, I don't know if you're going to move from Buffini to homes.com, but if you do, you'll be able to actually access all their social media profiles and their emails and their phone numbers all in one. So that would be a good tool.
By the way, there will be a webinar at 3:00 this Wednesday explaining the new homes.com websites, and they should go live to every agent on November 1st. So.
And does Lead Street go away on November 1st?
Well, no. I think there will be a crossover of through the end of the year. And then if you want to maintain your Lead Street website, you'll have to pay $50 a month to keep it. But the homes.com, it's like a single page website, will be free. I don't know about the CRM and all of that, if it will be included for free or if you have to pay extra for that, but we should find out all those details on Wednesday.
So it will be here?
It is a webinar.
Yeah.
I am going to try to do it live here, but you
okay.
can also just log in yourself. Just go to remax.net and search for the homes.com webinar, and you can get your own link.
What time did you say?
3:00 Central, 4:00 Eastern.
Do you know how long it's going to be?
I don't.
Okay, good. Now we're going to see target your prospects, how using a target area. Determine your target area. If you have a listing, then target the area that the listing is located, obviously. If you don't have a listing, make a list of neighborhoods that you would like to target. Number two, use strategic hashtags. Use local hashtags that will attract people in the area. Ideas, this is for, I did this one in Cypress, so those are the different type of ones in Cypress. Obviously, it would be different here. We talked about hashtagging Woodlands. We talked about Wood Forest. What are some other of the popular areas in this area, communities in the area?
Vendors Landing.
Harmony.
Jacobs Reserve
is a good one. So using those, hashtagging those is actually going to be really important for you guys, so that you're attracting the traffic that you want. And again, we've already talked about this again. a little bit. Follow local businesses and people. Search for users on Twitter. Search for areas like Tomball, Spring, or Cypress, Woodlands, Wood Forest. You should be able to find the school districts easily. Follow, retweet, and engage them. Now let's go. Let's do this. So now we're going to search. We're going to search Twitter. Because maybe there's an active, what they call socialite. I don't know if y'all know what this term means, but what it is, it's somebody that just makes money off of being a social person on social media. And different areas actually have socialites. There might be one for the Woodlands, so let's see. So the Woodlands, let's see who's popping up first there. So now you have the Woodlands Trust, the Woodlands NW, Woodlands Net, Woodlands Resort, Woodlands News. So I'm looking at it, and most likely the Woodlands News. So you do have a socialite, Bernadette. So Bernadette is going to be the socialite for the Woodlands. Looks like she's pretty popular. Let's see her profile. Yeah, she's extremely popular. She has 23,000 followers, and she had been active since June. So, oh no, there we go, 2 days ago. She's actually really active still. Okay, so this would be a good person to follow. So somebody that could expose your listings and whatever else you're posting on Twitter to over 21,000 people. So this is the type of people that you want to find on Twitter, the people that you want to engage with. She's highly popular. Let's look to see the Woodlands Resort, to see how many people they have. 4,000, that's a really large number for a business. Really good place to follow them. And so, we can go back. And the Woodlands Extra, all these different profiles are actually really good to engage. 2,000 is a high number as well. They don't have a banner though. They need a banner. But other than that, though, I mean, these are all really nice profiles to engage with, to retweet. That retweet button, again, is right here. You can also favorite it and reply to it. These are going to be the ones that you kind of want to get engaged with on Twitter, start getting exposure to there as well. And so, and then we can also, let's see what kind of schools that we have. Let's say Woodlands High School. Excuse me. So there's the Woodlands High School. That looks like just a basketball team. Let's see, maybe. What's the name of their mascot?
Highlanders.
I know they have one. Woodlands Highlanders. Try that.
WHS?
It's just got some expletives on there, so we won't go that far. But let's go. So now I can actually change my parameters, though. Instead of seeing tweets, I click that little right button up top, that little, you guys see that little measuring thing right there?
Mm-hmm.
Click that, and you can actually change who you're searching for. Or one of my top tweets, all tweets. There we go. So now we can click from everything. Now we can go to people. So now I've changed who else. So now, oh wow, this is really good. You even have the different teams. They have their own followers. So that's actually even more targeted than just the high school. You have the volleyball team, water polo, baseball, softball, all these different teams that are on here. These are actually really good profiles to be following. Even though the followers aren't as many people, it's highly targeted. And again, you're going to have all the parents that are going to be on here. The kids are going to be on there. So it's actually a really good one as well to use. So you want to change it from searching from everything and just go down to people. Then you can actually find the people that you want to follow. So that's a good tool to use as well. Okay, now this is one of the biggest things I want to talk to you about today. Using Google and YouTube to help you farm. Optimize your videos for search engine optimization using meta tags and descriptions that you need to target your audience and location. So there's actually a really good way to use your current listings to help you farm digitally for new leads. How do I do that? How's that going to help me? Well, what you do is, say if you're getting a lot of listings in a certain area, what you do is every time you get a listing, you set up that virtual tour, and you put the address on there, and you put that pipe that we talked about, the separator, you put the Woodlands, and you put another pipe, and you put home for sale, and that's it. You cut that off. Then you go down to the descriptions and the keywords, and you're going to fill that up with as much stuff as you want. But your title needs to be short, concise, to the point with the area that it's in, the address, and then homes for sale. And then that way, if you say if you're getting a lot of listings, you're using your listings to help that keyword homes for sale. So when people are searching, yeah, they're gonna find you because you have 30 or 40 YouTube videos from your listings, and it's all listed on your website and all your social media platforms. So you're helping your presence that way, and it's not a free way, because I know you had to work to get that listing. But once you get that listing, use that listing to your advantage to help you gain keywords and access for future buyers. So now you got that YouTube video in there. Go and use that same photo that you're using for the YouTube video that you have for that listing. Make a Google Plus photo album. Use that. So one of the products that I innovated earlier this year, like in January, February, we called it the listing plan. And every time the client got a listing, we beta tested it. And when we beta tested it, we noticed that if we did the YouTube video, the Google Plus photo album, and Pinterest, and we did all of those three items at the same time, like publish them within a day or two of each other, that when you went to Google, and I don't know if you know, on Google, we can go there, you can actually go, let's see, Safari, where are you at? So on Google, what is Yahoo? Let's go Google. On Google, when you search for something, this is all the content that comes up right here. But what we notice is that when people are searching for homes for sale in certain areas, the images section are actually getting a lot of attention as well. So whenever we published to YouTube, we did our Google Plus photo album, which is images. We did the Pinterest plan, and we also did a Facebook photo album. But what got us the attention was the Google Plus photo album and the Pinterest. That's what got us the most power. But for the next 2 to 3 days, if we did homes for sale in a certain area, our photo albums were popping up right here on this page on the very top. So
Kyle, do you have that listing plan in writing? And is that something that you share?
Yes, yeah, for sure. What I do is I have the listing plan in writing, and then I give you, if you, it's one of the things that you get from us, I give you an actual presentation to show your clients. So when you go and you're doing your listing presentation, you can show them where their home is going to be promoted on. You say, "Hey, if you list your home with me, I'll have your home listed on YouTube. I'll have it here on Google Plus. I'll have it here on Facebook. I'll have it here on LinkedIn." It'll actually show them how their home is being promoted on all the platforms, and that is probably where we saw the biggest increase of revenue for our clients, is because they were able to lock down that client. Because a lot of the feedback we got from the beta testing and before we actually rolled it out was that clients were experiencing, they're like, "Yeah, I know that my home is being listed," and they tell me that they're publishing it to over 3,000 websites, but I don't see that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see that. But what the clients do see, because if they're referral, especially if they're close to you, they're on your social media, they're on your Facebook, they're your friends, or they're following your business page. So when they see their home being promoted, it makes them feel a little bit more at ease and like, "Oh, this is cool. They're actually doing a lot of creative stuff." So not only does it help you out getting new listings, because you're going to be optimizing all of those posts for, like I said, put that address on there. The address makes the current client happy, and it helps you out with SEO. Throw the community or the address, not the community that it's in, like Woodlands, and then pipe it and then put homes for sale.
Now, when you refer to piping, you're talking about on the website.
No, I'm talking about this thing right here. It's called, whenever, let me show you. Let's go to one of my construction clients. Let's see, media blasting.
The reason I ask is, I created a video last week in YouTube and then posted it to Facebook, but the title that I could put in YouTube seemed pretty long, but when it posted to Facebook, it just picked up the first few words. It wouldn't put the whole title in.
Yeah, it'll do that. And it's just kind of shortening it up.
Yes.
For you.
I didn't want it short, though. I wanted the whole title.
That sometimes you can't help what Facebook does, because what they have is they shorten it pretty much everything. If it's a really long link, they'll shorten it up for you.
Okay.
Things like that. And but see, these are the pipes I keep referring to. See that pipe right there? So
were those created in YouTube, the pipes, in the title of the video?
I created them. Yeah, you can just say, I'm going to type media blasting. There's a little pipe on your keyboard. You hold down shift, and the thing is the forward slash. You pipe it. Because if you don't, what I would do is I would have to hope that this company that I market for, I would have to hope that their clients are searching for media blasting Houston, Texas, Cypress, Texas, all in one search.
Yeah, my point is, though, you wrote that title,
yes,
with the pipes as the title of the video in YouTube.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
I got you.
Yes, correct. So what we do is, because if not, then you would have to, now we're capturing media blasting in Houston,
mm-hmm,
we're capturing media blasting in Cypress, we're capturing media blasting in Texas. Because if you don't, if you do media blasting in Houston, Cypress, Texas, that would have to be their entire search.
Yes.
So for like a listing, that's why we would put like the address, the community that it's in, and then homes for sale.
Gotcha.
That way you're capturing it, and you can even do going to Texas, but you don't want to be too long. You don't want to be media blast in Houston, or you want to do homes for sale, address, Woodlands, Wood Forest, Spring, and keep going, because then you're losing your power.
Yeah.
You want to keep it short and concise.
So when you say address, should you include the whole, like everything, street name, city, state, zip?
Good question.
Are those all?
Let me show you. Let's go to one of my clients. Let's see. Let's go to our Facebook page. I did a little bit of experimenting on this to kind of see what got me the best results. Let's see here. Let's go back here. So like I do like on this one, like I didn't even put the address on there. This one was particularly, it's not showing you that. Okay, so why is it doing that? No, go back. Let's log out of YouTube. So like for this one, she got a contract on this one like the day after it was listed. So there was really no reason to put the address on there. So what I did, I just used this as an opportunity to help her get keywords in for her search. So it kind of depends on the listing. If like I left the home is going for sale like really, really quickly, then you want to kind of, if you don't have to, you don't need to. But we still use the opportunity to help her get more content for Home for Sale, Cypress, and Lakes of Rose Hill. See, for this one, I put Houston, Texas, and I just put the street name on there. I kind of differ a little bit about what we do to try to see what kind of results I get. It's more of a test and measure and analyze thing. It's to see what works, see how many views. So I can go here, and I can see that this one had 23, this one had 26, this one had 16. That one had none. This one had 99, so obviously that one had a lot of people pumped into it. So you can kind of just go in here and measure how many views that you're getting on your different titles and kind of learn from there. See, that one, I just put the straight address on there, and it got 15. This one, I broke it up into pipes, gave it a little bit more longer one, and I got 37, a little bit better review. So it's kind of like, what you call it? Test and learn, basically. Just kind of see what works, and then whatever works, you want to stick with that, and then kind of go from there. You don't want to keep going what doesn't work. So just it's kind of really up to you if that particular listing is being sold quickly or not. If it's already sold, and if it's going to be on market, because I know a lot of those homes during the summer that were listed at like 150 to 200. I mean, those were being going really quickly. So you could use those as opportunities, mostly just to promote homes for sale and your keywords. And if it's a higher regarded listing and the client's a little bit more higher maintenance and stuff like that, then you're probably going to want to see their home really done really nicely and things like that, then definitely include the address, make the client happy. But now let's go back to the presentation. Okay, so we talked about how to optimize posts on Google and YouTube. Optimizing posts for Google Plus is exactly the same way that you would do it on any other platform, using those keywords with the pipe thing. That's a really good way. And you can, instead of doing a video on Google Plus, you're going to do a photo album. And you're going to use the same hashtags, keywords, and everything that you're using, and use it for that particular listing there. Another extra thing to help you farm, create informative videos for your email marketing campaigns. One of my, actually my very first real estate client ever, she's my mother-in-law, and she is a REMAX agent up here at REMAX Integrity, I think, or one of the ones around here. One of the things, this was her idea, and it was, I'm not going to take credit for it, it was actually her idea, is she sits in front of her computer, and she does, she's in Bentwater, and she does a market report for Bentwater every month. Every single month, and this is a form of digital farming because she's using it, and she takes that YouTube video and she emails it to everybody in Bentwater that is her clients or their people in there, and they actually look forward to this email, and she says that most of her business comes from this video that she makes every month because people want to list their homes after they find out what the market report is doing, or it just creates top of mind. And it's not a fancy video. She sits right at her desk at her home, puts on a webcam, does the market report, sends out the video on the email. So all when they get the email, they get the video, they can click play. They don't have to click a link or anything. It's directly on the email. And she also supplies a digital PDF form of the report that she's talking about. And she gets a lot of business from it. So that's another way to do it. I always suggest doing it because it's something that does work. And like I said, I can't even take credit for that one. But again, now you want another good part of digital farming is linking all of your social media platforms to your Google Plus business. Now there's a big difference between Google Plus and Google Plus for Business. If you don't have your Google Plus for Business set up, then you're not showing up for search engines at all. Google is just regarding you as another person on Google Plus. But if you have a Google Plus business page, Google will actually mail you a hard copy of their verification. They'll have you type in all of the verification codes and things like that. And then you'll start appearing on Google Plus and as a real estate agent. And then so when somebody types in real estate agent in the Woodlands, they have a big list that comes up. We can actually check that out and see how it's popping up right now. So let's see, real estate agent. We should just type in real estate agent because it should pick up where we are. Okay, so now, y'all guys are popping up, the agency's popping up really good. So now, all of these are set up because these people have their Google Plus business page active, or they're just so popular that Google Plus created them a business page for them. So this is a highly, highly useful tool you need to have your Google Plus business page. So now I click on more real estate agent, and now it's bringing up all the people that have their Google Plus business page set up correctly. So now if you have your Google Plus page business page set up correctly, you should be popping up here.
Nice. We've got several of ours already.
Mm-hmm.
So this is really useful. And then if you have it set up correct, see this person doesn't have it too set up correctly because you can't navigate to their website. You have to verify your website. You verify, and then when you do this, Google Plus or Google will send you something to verify your address. Then once you verify your address, they'll be able to navigate directly from Google to your place of business, which is really useful. So again, Google Plus business pages highly, highly important, and having them set up and linked to your websites. And why is that important? Now we're going to link all of our social media platforms to Google Plus. And why are we going to do that? Because once we do that, now Google has now verified us that these are our social media platforms. So now we're no longer, we went way over time, guys. I'm sorry, I kept y'all long. It's 11:20, wow. So now that these platforms are actually being recognized for us, and not, if you don't link them to Google Plus, then you're not utilizing your power at all. You're just letting these social media platforms just kind of be out there. But if you attach them and link them to your Google Plus account, Google now has verified these as your profiles, and you'll start getting what we call search engine credit for all the posts that you do and hashtags that you do. All right, we're about to wrap up here pretty soon. Sorry I kept you guys a little long. To do follow campaigns on Instagram and Twitter, and also on Facebook. And the following campaign on Facebook will just be inviting your friends. Again, we talked about how to follow people on Tweetbee using that app for Twitter. And then now, make social media part of your daily routine. This will make it less of a chore. If you actually implement it into your part of your daily as well, something that you need to do, and you actually will value the information and the leads and the advertising that you're getting from social media, make it less of a chore, then you're going to start seeing it. Because if you see it as a chore, just something else to do, then you're not going to take the time and the effort that it takes to really make it work for you. To create creative and interesting content. Content, again, is very, very key. You don't want to just use this as an advertising firm or as an advertising platform. You want to engage people as much as possible. Content will drive traffic to your website. And then, again, to really know your plan, know your why. If building your database is your why, then always have every post, every single campaign that you run, it should always end up in getting more people into your database. Email campaigns, where you harvest all of your leads and referrals. Create an email marketing campaign specifically for buyers or sellers. Create a thank you message for all new email addresses and make it personal as possible. You probably already have that with, Brian Buffini. Create an email campaign for referrals. Again, we talked about how to do referral programs, cross promotions, things like that. Do that on email as well. If you have listings, include a campaign for those as well. So every time you get a listing, you should have all the photos on it. Make it HTTP friendly, which means it can be shared on social media and other websites so that it doesn't just show up as a text. It'll actually have pictures and everything, highly engageable, it's a lot easier to hit that forward button on that email than it is just text and attachments as photos. You want those photos on the body of the email itself. Nurture and grade your leads. If you get a really good lead on social media, if you're doing that, make sure you pay attention to them and also grade them. If you're consistently getting leads that are not qualified for loans or people that are currently don't have good credit and you're not helping them out, don't just throw those away, but don't pay as much attention to those people as you would somebody who is qualified. Grade them out. Remember to plant as many seeds as possible. And what that means is, like I said, don't throw away the leads that don't qualify for credit, because maybe in 6 or 7 months they might qualify. Be sure, if you plant that seed and they do become a part of your program, don't just throw them away. Communicate with them often and always keep your form automated so you don't have to work as hard. Try to keep your social media posts automated, keep your email marketing automated so that you're not spending time behind the computer, you're spending your time closing deals and showing houses. Now that you have your digital form created, you're going to create a referral email campaign. Create your welcome email campaign. Welcome to my email. I don't say email marketing, but welcome to my newsletter type of information. Create different automated messages for each group that you put your clients into. So if you have if they're going to click on their buyer's campaign, have that for them. If they're looking for information on selling, have different emails that they can get. Staging your home. What to do to prepare to sell your home, those type of emails. If they need to be receiving information that's pertinent to them and not just useful information but you always want to be doing like a holiday campaign for everybody. So like, you know, happy holidays, happy Halloween. That just again creates top of mind. Automate your social media posts with getting tongue-tied at the end. Hootsuite. Hootsuite's a really useful tool, but with homes.com, you may be able to get rid of Hootsuite. We'll see here soon. I don't know. I still haven't been able to find out the automatic posting for a homes.com program yet, but we'll see. Integrate traditional farming methods with your digital farming. Promote on flyers. So if you're sending out mailouts and things like that, be sure to put your Facebook URL and your Twitter URL onto your promotions and your flyers. cross promote, use your traditional farming methods. If you're going out, you're hitting the pavement, you're hitting the streets, and you're knocking on doors, and you're doing that type of farming, and you're sending out mailers, be sure to use your non-traditional forms. If you're talking to people face-to-face at an open house, whip your phone out, show them your Facebook business page, show them your Instagram. I have another class called the Social Open House, which actually I'll show you how to host an open house on Instagram and how to get every person that walks in there on Instagram. And you also, you can use that, I think I've talked to you about it, the Open Home Pro. Have y'all seen that app?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Using that in congruence with your social media, getting all those leads fed into there, get them on your social media and things like that. Really useful tool. And then integrate, we talk about that. Now, after you have your digital farm, after you have created a Facebook business page, and after, before you spend $1 in pay-per-click advertising, make sure your sphere of influence is on there. And after you do that, now you're ready to start doing pay-per-click lead gen and things like that. But make sure that your sphere of influence is onto your Facebook page, onto your social media, before you start spending money on advertising. And then that way you take advantage of again, the free things that come with shares, likes, and comments. And that pretty much concludes the class. Unless you have questions, I would be glad to answer any questions. I usually get a lot more questions. There's a lot more talking than questions today. So
Kyle, if we wanted your professional guidance, what would that cost?
It's really kind of just customizing on what you want to do. Right now, we are not accepting any more web design or any projects until the end of the year. And we don't do social media management. We don't manage it either. All we do is create and coach and mentor. So the only thing available right now is social media creation and coach and mentor, if that's something you'd be interested in. That usually is usually what we're doing on the class day specials. It's $100 a platform. So if you want Facebook created, it's $100. If you want Instagram, Pinterest, YouTube, all those platforms created, they're $100 per platform. And then, usually the websites are customized anyway and things like that. But right now we're not accepting any of those till the end of the year, because we're kind of just trying to focus on our clients and make them happy before we accept any new ones.
So $100 per platform to create. And then if we wanted your guidance on how to maximize those on an ongoing basis.
That's $100 per coach and mentor program as well. So if like I create that Facebook and you want 5 coach and mentor sessions, that would be $100 for the initial creation and $100 per meeting. So that'd be a total of $600.
Like an hour a meeting or something?
An hour meeting, but just like today went long, if we're sitting there, we're going back and forth, I'm not going to say, oh, I'm done. You know, I'm not going to do that to my clients.
Okay.
I'll take care of you until you get a full understanding of what you got going. We don't take on more than we can take. We believe that if we take on a number of clients, we should be able to give them the focus and attention they need. And then we don't manage people's social media. I did that one lady's. We do hers. We've had her since day one, so we can't just let her go.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't do that, because the best results, especially if you guys are following Ranger on Facebook, I don't know if you know, but he's doing it all himself, and he is getting a lot of attention because he takes the time to pay attention to it. He does it really well, and we think that's what the best thing is, as far as we are as a company, as far as because real estate agents, they're tech savvy, you know. Or if they have an assistant, then we coach and mentor their assistant on how to maintain it. But what we do is we like to keep our relationship strong and maintain everything that we know we can take on as a company. But are there any questions about the class, about how that goes? And like a little bit about what I plan on doing the next year or so is I actually plan on doing my own Brian Buffini style type of, but it's going to be strictly for social media. It's not going to be all that. It's going to have videos just like he has. But I'm going to be doing it for social media, and so that I won't have to come to each and every individualized session. What you'll be able to get from me is you'll buy the creation, you'll get all the banners, you'll get all the social media, and then you'll get a series of videos teaching you how to do it all yourself, and then access to me at any time as well. So I'm thinking that's where we're going to be at, because after the last 2 years of doing business, we learned that the coach and the mentor programs with the real estate agents just works out so well. And then we've also had a really good experience with Brian Buffini, and we think that if we can make our own style of that and make it successful, that would probably be the best results, because real estate, you have to consistently market yourself, as you know. So the agents doing it themselves, getting out there, whenever somebody walks in to their open house, talking to them, hey, this is what we got to do, check me out on Instagram, host, and then doing little selfies, talking to the people, that's what gets you the best results. If you have somebody managing it for you, then you don't have that face-to-face kind of personal touch that you would have as if you were managing yourself.
Okay, thank you, Kyle.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
So we have doctors.